Okay, friends, we'll go ahead and get started. My name's Rick Garnett. I'm the potted plant for this session, which means I'll read a few lines and sit down and won't say another word. We have a wonderful session this afternoon. We have with us James Mumford, who is a screenwriter, a journalist, and also a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Virginia. His first book, Ethics at the Beginning of Life, A Phenomenological Critique, was published in 2013 by Oxford University Press and was reviewed widely. Mumford was an undergraduate at some place called Oxford and a Henry Fellow at Yale. From 2010 to 2013, he worked for the Center for Social Justice, which is a British political think tank. And he writes on a range of ethical, political, and social issues for The Guardian, The Daily Telegraph, The Spectator, The Hedgehog Review, American Conservative, and Standpoint. His paper today will be called Rhetoric as the Vocation of Christian Artists.
Thank you for that fascinating talk. By the time you came into, we didn't do both of those, do we? By the time you came into, started to reflect on the phenomenology of, and do you want to turn this one off as well when you get a chance so it doesn't, thank you. I realized you sort of had in mind a lot of the questions that I've been recently. Like, my wife is always giving me a hard time for watching bleak movies, like Coen Brothers movies and other things, and I find such beauty in them. And then I'm sort of worried, like, why do I find beauty in very bleak films, right? That kind of, you know, what is that? What is going on there? And then I try and rationalize it and feel that, like, that God is through this and must be through this, and that maybe this is an exploration of our fallen condition, and unless we think about the world as unbelievers, like Professor McIntyre said, we can't understand the world as believers. And I felt that there was a sort of something going on that kind of, anyway, it's a great talk. You might as well just give it again and I'll sit down. But anyway, so if you can't understand my accent, it's because I'm from London, and so I'll try and speak in a way that's tolerable. I've been getting into trouble recently because I, in living in the States for the last few years, I've been trying to sort of do things differently, and one wants to sort of keep the accent, right? You know, but on the other hand, sometimes I confess that I do compromise. For example, when you're asked for your date of birth, in England we have this bizarre thing called logic where you sort of start with the smallest unit. So you begin with, like, my birthday's on the 28th of February 1981, so I begin with the 28th as the smallest bit, and then the month, and then the year. But here, as you know, you begin with the month, and then you go to the date, and then you go to the year. So I have to, every time I'm asked my date of birth, I'm in this agony, you know, do I give it as they'll understand it, or do I remain true to my colors? And so sometimes I do compromise and start with the February bit. And then also another problem I have recently is I like coffee strong, and so I ask for lots of room in the milk, but this gets me in trouble as well, because people look at me, and this one, I said, God, I'd love extra, lots of room in the milk, please. And this one charming girl who was serving me, she went back and came back and said, I talked to my manager, I'm afraid we can't let you have rum in your milk, in your coffee. So it gets me in trouble a lot. So I hope you understand what I have to say. But I want to talk about rhetoric as the vocation for Christian artists. And I hope this was a provocative title that sort of made you want to think about it. Because when I'm talking about rhetoric, I actually want to talk about rhetoric as in its classical sense, not as rhetoric in the way that we might think at the end of this campaign season as the use of language to manipulate and to deceive, but rhetoric as the use of speech and language to give full representation and to bring to the level of discourse and to thematize elegantly in a way that does justice to its subject. That's what I mean by rhetoric. And there is particularly in speech is what my talk is going to be about. Could I just ask, this is obviously going to be a fantastic talk for everyone, but are there particularly people here who would describe themselves as artists, either film directors and producers, or lyricists and writers, and anyone as well as me? A few people? Okay, great. Well, so this talk is specifically to you, so everyone else could just No, not really. So let me give you an example of like an occasion that makes me kind of feel a little bit sad about rhetoric and the failure of rhetoric. Because rhetoric, as I've just described it, is something in which you can succeed or fail. And that's Father of the Bride speeches. Now, I won't go and give you all my favorite examples. And my wife thinks I'm a terrible person because now we had lots of people at our wedding, and then we had lots of return matches. We went to like 50 within 3 years of getting married, and we, you know, weren't able to buy people presents. So I think they then stopped inviting us. Oh, got the rumor got round that we didn't bring presents to weddings and so forth. Anyhow, we would go to these, and she said, "You go to weddings like you're going to a Formula One, you know, game where you're just, you know, Formula One event. You're just waiting for the crash." And so I am a bit cynical, but one of the things that strikes me and I find sad about Father of the Bride speeches, in particular, is that here you have this moment where the whole audience is behind you as a father, and everyone is riveted about your subject because she looks magisterial and elegant and beautiful, and it's one of the great days in her life. And people want to know, what is it specifically about this person that you have insight, you have a lifetime, her lifetime of insight into who this person is, and now you have the chance in language and in speech, in rhetoric, to do justice to your subject in all her radiance, and everyone wants to know about it. I mean, this is like a dream. I don't have to, you know, spend any time trying to win over the audience with, like, you know, crappy stories about having coffee and, you know, rooming your coffee. You're like, they're there with you, right? And what happens? What do you hear about? You hear that Isabel weighed 6 pounds and 2 ounces. Thanks. You hear that I can still hear the screech of flute practice when Leanne was in first grade, like every other. We all know that. We can all hear that. We identify. You hear about the name of the first boyfriend. Like, we don't really care about the name of the first boyfriend. Tell us. Tell us who this person is. And it makes me sad. And sometimes, of course, you're overwhelmed by emotion. And I have 2 daughters, so I'll probably be a wreck. But, you know, even that I don't feel is quite an excuse. Because actually, you could have, even if you don't enjoy public speaking, I mean, you could have thought about it. You've had a lifetime to think about it and write it and then present it. And tell us, you know, just get someone else to give it, you know. But just do justice to the reality of your subject. And that's what rhetoric is for me, okay? And so I want to talk about rhetoric, and I want to use film mainly to do. I'm like one of those teachers who like comes in and hasn't prepared and just puts on The Rise of the Nazis, you know, on the documentary. Anyhow, so I just want to show a couple of films, and then we can sit down and ask questions about the Inferno. This is the sort of formal academic-y bit, which is a text from the Renaissance, a famous English writer, Sir Philip Sidney, and this is what he said about rhetoric, or poetry. He talks about, on the one hand, you have the historian who has all these different details but can't get to the truth of life or the universal structures of experience or value, the heart of value that, as Steve McAfee was saying this morning, is what is trying to be communicated in art. They can't get to these great truths because it's just so much detail and you can't pick things out of the detail. So that's the historian. And then on the other side, you have the philosopher who deals in general precepts, as he calls it, general notions, but can only communicate them abstractly and therefore can't get to the heart of the thing in a way that can move us. And so he says that the poet, or I want to call the orator, the person who deals with rhetoric, that rhetoric does both of these things, but is a third kind of person, is a third kind of task. And he says, the peerless poet couples the general notion with the particular example. So the general notion is the philosophy bit, and the particularity, the particular example, is the detail and is the sort of historical example. He gives a perfect picture, this is the person who does rhetoric, yielding to the powers of the mind an image which strikes, pierces, and possesses the sight of the soul. And so let me give a couple of instances of the particular example. And in the wedding speech, it would be something like those illustrations that nobody else would know that take you to the heart and the feel of a person, you know? So the first clip I had that I wanted to give an example from is from a BBC adaptation. Every reference here is going to be to English literature, by the way. And this is from Little Dorrit. It's the BBC adaptation with Tom Courtney playing William Dorrit. And basically, what happens in this scene is that Little Dorrit, Amy Dorrit, is the daughter of William Dorrit, who lives in the Marshalsea. And the Marshalsea was a prison in 19th century England, where you went if you were in debt, because you could be imprisoned for being bankrupt. So he spent a lot of his life in the Marshalsea. She's allowed to come in and out to see him, so it's kind of a prison with, you know, not the most intense security, but he can't leave. And in this scene, he's talking about his life and about feeling insignificant. And the setup is just to sort of get you used to what's going on. Not hugely important, but the occasion for when him then talking about it is that she has rejected a marriage offer from the son of the gatekeeper here. And he is disappointed. William Dorrit, her father, is disappointed by this. Can we dim the lights a little bit? Is that possible?
There you are, father. Supper's all ready. Let me take your coat.
Thank you, my dear.
Did you enjoy your walk with Uncle?
Not much, Amy. Not much, in point of fact.
Why? What's the matter, Father?
I feel a little disturbed, a little uneasy.
Tell me what it is, Father.
Something's gone wrong with Chivery. Something seems to have upset or annoyed him. It puts me out, my love. It's impossible to...
Sorry, let me just work out a way of putting this in the whole screen. There we go. Thank you.
Forget that in such a life as mine, I am unfortunately dependent on these men for something or other every hour in the day. Good heavens, were I to lose the support of Chivery and his brother officers, I might well starve to death here.
I'm sure that would never happen, Father.
You say that. I can't think what it's owing to. Can you? Yes, I remember there was a certain young turnkey here once by the name of Jackson, and he paid his addresses to, not the daughter, no, the sister of one of us, a rather distinguished collegian. His name was Captain Martin, and this Captain Martin consulted with me as to whether his sister should hazard offending the turnkey by being too plain. With him. Captain Martin felt, and I agreed with him, that his sister, was not called upon to understand the young man too distinctly, if you follow me, that she might tolerate him on her father's. On her brother's account, and so she did. I hardly know how I've strayed into this story. I suppose it's through not being able to account for Chivery that, as to the connection between the two.
Come, Father. Eat your supper.
What does it matter whether I eat or starve? What does it matter whether such a blighted life as mine comes to an end now, next week, next year? What am I worth to anyone?
Oh, Father, don't say such things.
Oh, Amy, if you could see me as your dear mother saw me, I was young, I was accomplished, good-looking, and people sought me out and envied me. They envied me.
Oh, Father, don't distress yourself.
Yet I have some respect here. I'm not quite trodden down. Go and ask who is the chief person in this place. They'll tell you it is William Dorrit.
I know, Father.
Go and ask who is never trifled with. They'll tell you it is William Dorrit.
I know, Father.
Go and ask what funeral here will make more talk, yes, and perhaps more grief than any that has ever gone out of that gate. And I tell you,
So that's a scene in, I find particularly moving, and it's an example precisely of what I think Sidney means when he says that that the particular example betrays the general notion, and the particular example is given, you know, this extraordinary scenario which betrays, which reveals, which gives a way into the general notion of a man's experience in the world of insignificance and of a pining for insignificance, and a pining for significance, which I think is, you know, particularly marked for men. Let me give an example now of something that is for women a particularly key moment and rite of passage, and this is from the film Boyhood. Anyone seen Boyhood, the film, the movie, which was extraordinary, made over 12 years. It's the ultimate coming of age movie. They started filming it when the boy protagonist was 10 years old, and then he's 18 at the end of the movie. And it's about his mothers and his fathers who get divorced there, or are divorced from the beginning and separated, and about how they interact. And Patricia Arquette plays his mother, who won the Best Supporting Actress for her role in this. And if you haven't seen it, I'm going to give you the last scene, so sorry. But this is another universal experience which rhetoric is is doing justice, that I want to show as an example of rhetoric is doing justice to. So have you got that? Is that all right? So this is about empty nesting.
Did you put this in here again? I don't want it.
Come on, it's the first picture you ever took.
Well, I mean, all the more reason to leave it behind, right? What?
Nothing.
No, what is it?
Nothing.
Mom.
This is the worst day of my life.
What are you talking about?
I knew this day was coming. I didn't know you were going to be so fucking happy to be leaving.
Sorry about that.
I mean, it's not that I'm that happy. What do you expect?
You know what I'm realizing? My life is just going to go like that. This series of milestones. Getting married, having kids, getting divorced. The time that we thought you were dyslexic when I taught you how to ride a bike. Getting divorced again, getting my master's degree, finally getting the job I wanted. Sending Samantha off to college, sending you off to college. You know what's next, huh? It's my fucking funeral. Just go and leave my picture.
Aren't you jumping ahead by like 40 years or something?
I just thought there would be more.
Okay, great, thank you. So in saying, you know, I just thought there would be more, brings me to my next point, which is that why is it valuable that we have rhetoric? Why is it? This is my next example. thank you. Why is it valuable that we have rhetoric as Christian artists? Well, one of the things is that we're giving a sense of the world which Christ came to redeem, and of moments and dynamics and syndromes and rites of passage like empty nesting, at which a moment that if we do justice to them in our writing and in our speech and in our art, then we represent occasions and we show why it is that that God comes to break into these moments, and why theologically we can think about moments of inbreaking of his glory. And so those kind of, maybe this is too much of the sort of, you know, let's get examples for youth group talks, I think there's something to that. But, you know, when she says, you know, there must be more to life than this, or there has to be more, I think that the writing there is, and the story and the development, which is obviously the whole film, even over a 12-year period, is, you know, driving towards this. You know, he knew what he was doing, the script was written, is attesting to something about the human condition and about the way that life is slipping away from us, which is something that we have to attest to, because it's part of the human condition that Christ came to redeem, and in which Christ comes to meet us. So I think that's the first part of what an example of what Sydney is doing in his definition of rhetoric, and why it's important that rhetoric is a vocation for Christian artists. The second point, and I'm going to skate over this. Could you give me, there we are. How are we doing on time? Okay, so the second point I want to make is that the task of Christian artists is to recognize the triumph of rhetoric in our culture, and for there to be moments of affirmation as well as criticism. And in peace with Alistair MacIntyre, one of my favorite philosophers, I say quickly, that I think that our moment is one of the richest for the imagination in contemporary culture. And I think that what we're seeing at the moment is absolutely extraordinary. In the golden age of television, in music, in lyricism, I think that the things that we might criticize in our culture and be rightly see the evils of, like the capturing by social media and the vituperative nature of it that we've seen this week, and the ugliness of that, or the decadence in our society, and all of the ways in which that pervades us and breaks human relationships. I think that the cultural achievements and the rhetoric and the speech and the doing justice to human reality in art escapes both of those two things, and we have seen just an astonishing vitality in so many of the arts. I think the only way you could say that the Catholic and the secular imagination, you know, is not what it was in 1922 when James Joyce wrote Ulysses, and I love Ulysses, by the way, is if you defined poetry as exhausting the imagination. Now, I love poetry. I was a poetry major. But I think it's important to include lyricism and songwriting within the context of the imagination. That's not to say that songwriting is the same thing as poetry. So I don't necessarily think the Nobel Prize for Literature should have gone to Bob Dylan. But I do think that it's crucial that we define the imagination more broadly, because it allows us to see some of the extraordinary things that are happening. And I'll skate quickly over some of this. And I kind of like it if you haven't heard of some of my references, because you will have your own examples. And I think it's very important that we give voice and affirm those things, because they're doing justice to our experience as human beings in the world. So, you know, there's attestations that capture the particular detail, as Sydney says, of family breakdown. And I've got a PowerPoint, right? So this is a song by Neutral Milk Hotel about family breakdown. And in a very plaintive voice, he sings, and your mother would sing until she was no longer speaking, and Dad would dream of all the different ways to die, each one of them a little more than he could dare to try. That, which I've always found a very moving aspect of an attestation to family breakdown. I won't go through all the examples, but the things I'm thinking of are Kendrick Lamar's extraordinary eloquence on To Pimp a Butterfly, I'm thinking about Sufjan Stevens's amazing album about his parents and the orphaning he experienced in Kerry and Lowell. I'm thinking of Beyoncé's album, Lemonade. I mean, one of the most extraordinary visual things I've ever seen. And someone who emerges and breaks out to tell a story about the female experience of infidelity that just arrested me, because I realized if I had an affair, look what this would do to my wife. I mean, it was just, I mean, I've made my covenant vows, but to be reminded of that by a video as powerful of that as that, that moves through these different songs from anger to, from surprise, shock to anger to grief to the possibility of reconciliation, and all done in the angriest of rap music and the most beautiful of lyricism. I think it's just an absolutely extraordinary achievement that, you know, is far better than Robert Browning, Peace with Robert Browning. Unimportant English Victorian poet. Then I could get started on Radiohead, but we wouldn't have any time left. Or a song like Little Talks, which is a really interesting song by Monsters and Men, you know, which gives an amazing account of dementia and the intriguing virtuosity of the lyricism, whereby she sings a line about, she sings the part, and it becomes operatic, she sings the part of a woman who's suffering from dementia and the dementia is advancing and she's aware of this. And then she sings one line and then her husband will sing, the male singer, sings back to her the reassurance, and you have this constant back and forward throughout the song. And so this again is an example of amazing rhetoric and of doing justice to the pain and of that phenomenon. And let me finish with two thoughts. Well, I've got one more point, and then I want to finish with an encouragement to artists particularly. First, my final main point is that it's also the calling of Christian artists specifically to do justice, i.e. to take up the challenge of rhetoric in relation to talking about faith. And this is incredibly challenging. As a writer myself, and I've been writing a screenplay about a particular figure who has a conversion. I'm not going to tell you, obviously, because you would go and steal it. But in it is a conversion scene, and the, you know, the conversion is around which everything centers. And it's taken me 2.5 years of constant failure to write about the reality that I'm most intimate with and presumably best poised to write about, which is the reality of what it means to experience the Spirit and what it means to live by faith. Because I've not had the language. I just collapse into cliche every time I write the stupid scenes. I've rewritten the conversion actual moment hundreds of times, and drafts have gone back to my editor and producer just every time saying, this doesn't communicate to us, this is so cliched and so forth. And it's amazing how hard it is to write about faith itself. And I've been saying that it's not just writing about faith that's our vocation, but it's so hard. It's so difficult not to just collapse back into old ways of speaking. I think someone who achieves this amazingly is Marilyn Robinson, who I don't have time to speak about. But I would like to show one last clip from Terrence Malick. And this is from The Tree of Life, and it's the voiceover from Brad Pitt. And it's the language that he draws upon that I want to highlight after showing the clip. Sorry about this.
No, I wanted to be loved because I was great. A big man. I'm nothing. Look, the glory around us. Trees and birds. I lived in shame. I dishonored it all and didn't notice the glory. Foolish man.
They're closing the plant.
Yeah, there you go. Thanks. So you can put the lights back on now if you wouldn't mind. Thanks. So again, there's an interesting link to the Dickens and the sense of a man looking back on his life and feeling the pain of insignificance, and that's what the story is about. But it's particularly the line he says about dishonoring the glory. And for me, what Malick has achieved is a freshness of language about faith, which is the register of glory. And he talks about dishonoring the glory here, which I take to mean that he wasn't open to the transcendent and he missed it in the created order. And it refers back to how Malick envisages and talks about faith in The Thin Red Line, his war film about the war in the Pacific, where one of the characters says that I reached out and touched the glory, and that suddenly becomes a language which I think communicates and resonates in our culture, where finding faith or being born again, or you know, these words that just collapse and mean nothing and become a way of describing population groups and, you know, on maps in on election night, you know, like born again. And yet to talk about reaching out and touching the glory, to talk about dishonoring the glory, to talk about missing the glory, is a particular example where I think of rhetorical success when talking about faith. Does that make sense to you guys? Okay, good. And I just want to make a final point, which is to encourage particularly the artists here with something that I found really encouraging. And I'm not going to go back to the old. Is it going to be too difficult to go back to the old? I've got one last PowerPoint, not another clip. But this is a quotation from T.S. Eliot about writing. And T.S. Eliot's my favorite writer, and you'd think that it came naturally to him, right? And it's rather encouraging when there are writers that you admire so much who talk about how difficult it is to write. And so he talked about the challenge it is, and that this model, the flash of genius model, that's great, so there it is, brilliant. So the flash of genius model is not actually, the romantic model of inspiration is not actually where rhetoric is forged. And that's what I want to bring out with this final quotation. He says that writing is trying to learn to use words, and every attempt is a wholly new start. It's learning to get the better of words, where each venture is a new beginning, a raid on the inarticulate, with shabby equipment always deteriorating in the general mess of imprecision of feeling, undisciplined squads of emotion. So he talks about the challenge of it, but then he finally talks about the encouragement. And he says, for us, there is only the trying. The rest is not our business. Thank you very much for listening.